We'd like to welcome you to Wednesday Words. Thank you for joining us. We've been going through our book study called Mastering Life Before It's Too Late. There are 10 strategies that help us for a lifetime of purpose. We've covered 5 so far. We're still in the 5th strategy, which was simply this: pull off at rest stops, trying to replenish your resources routinely. And that was what was the subject of last week, how we talked about we need rest, we need to schedule times and not overwork ourselves. And we live in a fast-paced culture. It's easy to get into that system and that routine of doing things constantly, and we need some rest. Today, Robert's going to continue to build on that thought of resting. But here's this, here's the headline, or here's the title of this section of that strategy: only do what only you can do. Do you ever find yourself trying to do not only what you can do, but trying to do everybody else's work as well? That will wear you out quickly. And we need to try to hone in and determine what God has called us to do, what skills and gifts and abilities He's given us, and to utilize those and to help other people around us to help them find what they can do as well. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 5, the Bible says this: the Lord has assigned to each his task. And when we're in the Lord's will, we find happiness. But listen, there's little happiness to be found when you're not only doing what you can do, but you're trying to do other people's task as well. We need to find what we can do, what God has assigned us to do, and do that well. There are 2 cases in Scripture that really highlight this idea and this thought of doing what you can only, what you can do. One is found in the Old Testament in the book of Exodus when Moses, as he was leading the people, he grew overwhelmed in the workload that he had. People were lining up, coming to him, and he would hear their cases, and it just got to the place where he couldn't do anything else but just simply listen and make judgments and give counsel to them. But one day in Exodus chapter 18, he had a visit from his father-in-law, who was also a former employer, and Jethro was his name. He was a very astute businessman. He observed Moses and what was going on. He looked at what was happening, and he came and gave Moses some advice. The advice he gave him was as relevant today as it was back then. Here's what he said. He said, "Moses, what you are doing is not good. You and these people who come to you will only wear yourselves out. The workload is too heavy for you. You cannot handle it alone." Can you imagine the Lord coming to you and speaking those words personally and presently to you? Imagine Him saying to you that, listen, what you're doing is not good. You're trying your best, you're working your hardest, but you'll only go into wear yourself out and others. It is too heavy for you. You can't handle it alone. Well, the question is, what do we do about it? Well, Jethro offered Moses some advice, and here it was. He said, select some qualified people, get them organized into a system, give them some training, assign them work to do, and only the most difficult cases should come to you, Moses. That will make your load lighter because they will share it with you. Jethro said, if you do this and God so commands, you'll be able to stand the strain and all these people will go home satisfied. Now, he learned to do only what he could do because God had prepared others to do what he could not do and what he should not do. And so we find a wonderful story there in Exodus 18. Over in the New Testament, there's equally a great story of example of finding what you can do and doing it your best. In Acts chapter 6, verse 2, here's what it says concerning the disciples. It says, "It would not be right, they said, for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of spirit and wisdom, and we'll turn this responsibility over to them and we'll give attention to prayer and the ministry of the word." They did exactly what Moses did in Exodus 18. Now, looking back on that, on what they did in Acts chapter 6, without that strategic decision, the growth of the church would have been bottlenecked. But when the apostles, like Moses, learned to do what only they could do, the word of God spread, the number of disciples increased, and certainly a large number of priests became obedient to the faith, according to Acts chapter 6. Even Jesus Christ himself, the most pleasantly productive person in history, lived by this rule. In Acts chapter 10, verse 38, the Bible says that Jesus went around doing good. He went around doing good, anointed by the Holy Spirit. It does not say that he went around doing everything. He did not. As a matter of fact, Jesus knew how to work himself out of a job. He was a master delegator. He devoted much of his time to preparing a handful of people and giving them responsibilities, and they helped continue his cause. Jesus, in the book also of Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, Jesus began his work with these words. He said, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." That was his core message. Repent, the kingdom of heaven is near. But his second announcement was two verses later, and here's what he said. "Come, follow me, and I'll make you," what? "Fishers of men." First thing Jesus did was articulate his message. The second thing he did, he was delegating the work of spreading it around so it could get done. Jesus called those 12 disciples to him later, gave them authority. He sent them out with assignments to do the work. That was our Lord's strategy. He was always training others to shoulder the work he began, and that's still his method with us. D.L. Moody, the great Baptist preacher, said, "I'd rather get 10 men to work than to do the work of 10 men." Now, the only thing Jesus could not delegate was his death on the cross. No one could die righteously for the sins of the world. But as soon as he accomplished that task and risen again, what did he do? He gave them once again, he commissioned his followers to go into the world and to spread the gospel. "All authority," he said, "has been given to me on heaven and on earth." And he said, "Go into all the world, make disciples of all men, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you." If Jesus couldn't do everything by himself, neither can you or I. If Moses couldn't bear the strain of misappropriated work, neither can we. If Peter and his apostle needed to transfer some of the work to others, so do we. So you and I, if we're going to be pleasantly productive, we have to ask ourselves this question: what are the things that alone I can do, only I can do? Or to put it like this, what am I currently doing that I can persuade, hire out, assign, delegate, or somehow shift to someone else or release undoing? We got to figure out what we can do and only what I can do. We need to take everything else and begin finding ways to pass it along to others or to retire it to the region, Robert Morgan said, of the discarded. That's not laziness, it's biblical wisdom. Follow your strengths, build on your assets, find the way God seems to best use you, and swim with the current. Only do what you can do. Only you can be a husband or wife to your spouse. Only you can be a parent to your children. Only you can be a grandparent to those youngsters. And only you can fill a unique role in the life of someone who is special to you. Only you can nourish your soul and care for your body in a way that's pleasing to the Lord. And so we need to find what God has gifted us to do and do only what you and I can do. And allow others around us to help the cause of finding what God desires for us to do. David Jeremiah, the great pastor out in California, said, "Some years ago, I made a list of things I just wasn't going to do anymore. And one of those things," he said, "was serving on a particular board. The workload was too heavy, and I realized God hadn't called me to serve there. Someone else could do it just as well or better. If I had tried to serve on a lot of boards, I'd be distracted from my true life's work for which God had equipped me." CEO Michael Hyatt also has a not-to-do list, which he claims is as important or more so than his to-do list. Writing in his blog, he said, "The only way for super productive people to continue to grow professionally without growing crazy is periodically to decide what they are not going to do." Now, you and I need to figure out what we can do. What has God gifted you to do? What does he have a passion to do? And don't try to do everything. As a matter of fact, don't try to do everything in one day. And we need to have some rest time. We need to find ways that we can be pleasantly productive in doing what God has gifted you and I to do. And so this week, as you listen to that 12-year-old, as you redeem the time, as you clear the decks, and you maximize the morning, and as you pull off at rest stops, let's find what God has gifted us to do and do only that. And let's be pleasantly productive and master life before it's too late. God bless you. I hope you have a great week. And thank you for joining us today.